Welcome back to the greatest book club in the world, the book club, yay! And today we're on a very special episode. They are extremely special episodes we are today. We're on episode 122. Damn, 122 episode. It's going out, they are going out, guys. They are going very, very hard. And you know why it's so special? Because if you can look at the title, probably didn't notice, but it's the first time I think that I'm using a green aura on my title. So yeah, green. So it's fit for this grand breakout. And if you want to check out this grand princess, you know, you can find there. 3, 2, 1, go! You can find them on GoodFund. And this was created by Vanilka on March 2014. Wow, long time. So of course they're going to put a thumb up. And just to let you guys know. It was created on 2014, almost 8 years ago. And you see, now I'm using it. So you never know when you're putting something, when you produce content, guys, you don't know, you never know where it's going to take you. And 8 years after background was created, we are using it right now. So guys, just create content like I'm doing. I don't know where it's going to take me, this podcast, but just keep creating content and you never know when it's going to take you. So back to the picture. If you want to download it, if you want to download the picture, just left click on the picture, right click, Shmirat Monad Bashem or Save Picture S, and kabam, you got the full resolution of the picture on your computer. Saying that, if you're on the channel, welcome, and then if you're on the family of the channel, welcome back. My name is Eken, I'm the host. On this podcast, on this book club, we are working together on English speaking level and on reading level, and on communication skill to stand in front of the camera and have the confidence to stand in front of the camera. I'm doing so because I truly believe that English is the number one tool that each one of us must acquire in order to be successful in life. And the second tool that is going to help us a lot is to know how to communicate well through the camera and to have confidence and to have fun doing that. And which means, I can tell you from my own experience, when I started, I was a little bit nervous to stand in front of the camera. And now I can just do whatever I want to do. I'm not changing anything. I'm just got the confidence. I can do whatever I want to do because I'm working on it on each day, 5 episodes per week. And right now I'm in the challenge to shoot at least 5 episodes per day. So because I have 12 days until I'm coming back to work and 12 days double, 5 episodes per day equals 60 episodes, which means I'm going to create so much content in the next 2 weeks, which is going to be great. So let's continue. And today we'll continue with the great book. I really love the book, The Art of the Deal by Donald J. Trump. I really like it. I really enjoy it. It's easy English, a lot of nice story. We get a lot of nice thought about from this book. I really like it. And this is why I'm so pumped up to shoot 5 episodes per day, because actually, love this book and truly enjoy reading this book. And if we compare it to The Denial of Death, which was a previous book that we read, is that we read on the channel, I enjoy the book and learned a lot of it, but it was in more academic English, which took me much more energy to process it and to understand it. And I was really tired when I finished the series to shoot every episode. And right now I'm really enjoyed. So let's go, let's just go. And if you want to check out this grand account, or if you want to check out Donald J. Trump, a social media account, you can find all of them in the description below. So guys, don't forget to like this video, press subscribe, and put the notification bell on, so you can will be the first one to know when a new exciting episode are coming to uploading to YouTube. And to tell you, because I'm I start to record all my episodes in advance, I'm uploading to YouTube in schedule. I'm scheduling the uploading and I try to upload all of them on 8 p.m. Israel time. I don't know what it's what time, but it's Israel time, 8 p.m. So now you can know where all my episodes are going to come. So let's go, let's just continue. And we finished the previous episode with a story. When Donald Trump tell us how he bought the railroad yard in Manhattan for Victor. Let's see what he is going to continue saying. So, The Art of the Deal, page 88, 86, written by Donald J. Trump, the previous US president. Read, but Amit, the legend, the one and only. The man himself, give me some drum, please. Young boy, AK, that's me. So let's go. Victor banks on people and he decided to take a shot on me. He ended up suggesting that I developed not only the 60th yards, but also the yards on West 34th Street. In short, I probably oversold myself to him. I had no other choice. I was 27 years old. Damn. Which makes me think when I'm 29 and a half years old, when I am, where I am and where he is. Oh, well, it's... I feel a little bit sad. I didn't achieve so much in my life compared to him. But anyway, we have now the. This is why this is one of the reasons that I'm reading the book like this, to get motivated and to know where I can push myself to be. I was 27 years old at the time, and I had never built anything in Manhattan, nor had my father. Much as Victor liked me, I don't think he could have justified going with me if he hadn't believed our company was big and powerful. We had no formal name for the company when I met Victor, so I began to call it the Trump Organization. Somehow the word organization made it sound much bigger. Few people knew that the Trump Organization operated out of a couple of tiny offices on Avenue Z in Brooklyn. The other thing I promoted was the relationship with politicians, such as Avraham Beam, who was elected a mayor of New York in November of 1973. My father did belong to the same Democratic club that Abin came out of, and they didn't know each other. Like all developers, my father and I contributed money to Beam and to other politicians. The simple fact is that contributing money to politicians is very standard and accepted for a New York City developer. We didn't give any more to Beam than a lot of other developers did. In fact, it often seemed to me that perhaps because we knew Beam personally, he almost went out of his way to avoid any appearances that he was doing us any special favors. Instead, I spent most of the 4 years when Beam was the mayor trying to promote the West 34th Street site for a convention center. It was by far the best site of the Merits. And we eventually got nearly a big name in New York City. New York City businessmen behind us. Still, Beam never came out in support of the site until a few weeks before he left office. Nor did he ever give it his official approval. It was that court, newly elected in 1978, who finally chose our site for the convention center. No one, so far as I know, has ever suggested that Donald Trump and head coach are close personal friends. But that is getting well ahead of the story. By building a close relationship with Victor from the start, I was able, in effect, to work for him, rather than to be just another buyer. That was terrific for me. For example, we drew up agreements, giving me an exclusive option to purchase the 60th Street and the 30th Street street yards. But subject to zoning, subject to approval by the court, ending the firm settlement bankruptcy, subject to everything, expect my having to put up any money. The firm settlement even agreed to pay my development costs. It was remarkable in a way, the seller paying for the cost of the potential buyer. Still, you have to put it into perspective. What sounds like a stupid deal today was very different at a time when no one wanted to build anything, and the city was dying. Penley, in turn, helped give me credibility with the press. When he was asked by the reporter from Barnes why he chose Trump over others, he said, "Those properties were nothing but a black hole of undefinable risk." We interviewed all kinds of people who were interested in them, none of whom had what seemed like the kind of drive, backing, and imagination that would be necessary. Until this young guy, Trump, came along. He is almost a throwback to the 19th century as a promoter. He is larger than life. At one point, when I was hyping my plans to the press, but in reality getting over, a big New York real estate guy told one of my close friends, Trump is a great line of shit, but where are the brakes and the mortar? I remember being outraged when I heard that, and I didn't speak to this guy for more than a year. But looking back, I can see he was right. It could all have gone up in smoke. But if I hadn't managed to make one of those first projects happen, if I hadn't finally convinced the city to choose my West 34th Street site for its convention center, and then gone on to develop the grand height, I'd probably be back in Brooklyn today, collecting grants. I had a lot riding on those first projects. On July 1979, 1974, we announced that the Trump Organization had secured options to purge the two waterfront sites from the Penn Central. West 59th Street to West 72nd Street, and West 34th Street to West 39th Street, at a cost of $62 million. Damn! With no money down, the story made the front page of the New York Times. Well, my original idea was to build a middle-income housing on the sites at rents that seemed ridiculously cheap today, $110 to $125 a room, but considered moderately high at the time. I planned to seek a financing from the Michel Lama program, for which the city provided low interest. Long-term mortgages and tax abatements to builders. The program had been initiated to encourage middle-income housing. The month before our announcement, Victor and I, and some of his people met with Ed Beam to sound him out about our development plans. Although he was encouraging, from the moment we went public, he refused to take any position until our plan had been considered by the city agencies, including the City Planning Commission, the Board of Estimate, and the local community boards. He was a politician, and he wanted to see which way the winds were blowing before he took a stand. No sooner had I announced my plans publicly, then other bidders for the rail yards suddenly came out of the woodwork. Starlet Housing, for example, a company we were partners with from the Starter City Housing Project in Brooklyn, made a bid of $150 million, contingent on financing and the city approvals and all the rest. On the face of it, the bid was a lot higher than mine. I'm the first to admit that I am very competitive and that I will do nearly anything within legal bounds to win. Sometimes a part of making a deal is denigrating your competition. In this case, I happen to generally believe that the starter bid wasn't legitimate. the company would never close the deal and would not be able to successfully develop the site even if the deal did go through. The fact is that anyone can build anything, particularly when there are all sorts of contingencies. The same thing could be said about my bid. Expect that by then I'd put in enough time and effort to convince the Palmeries people that I was very serious and very committed. In the end, I managed to convince Palmeries that it made more sense to stick with my $62 million bid than to take a failure on a startup. The irony is that less than a year after I announced my plans for the site and beat my competition, the economic situation in New York City turned from bad to much worse. In February 1975, the Urban Development Corporation, the state agency that sold bonds to finance public housing, defaulted on more than $100 million of repayment on its bonds. In September 1975, BIM announced that because of the fiscal crisis, the city was suspending its own plans to finance the construction of virtually all new housing. In November 1975, the state announced that it too was suspending any financing of lower and middle income housing for the next 5 years, including a huge number of city projects that had already received the preliminary approval. You couldn't get up in the morning without running across some new headline about the city's fiscal crisis. I can't say that any of this made me truly fearful about the city's future. Still, when it became clear that I wasn't going to get any subsidy to build housing, I decided to try a new tack. I'd always thought that the West 34th Street site would be perfect for a new convention center. The problem was that nearly everyone else had other ideas. For starters, the city, with the support of many prominent local businessmen, had already spent more than 3 years studying and trying to develop another site by the Hudson River at 34th Street and 44th Street. In the planning process alone, the city acknowledged $13 million had been spent, but people I knew told me that the number was actually closer to $50 million. Damn. Then just weeks after the city said it wouldn't finance any new housing, BIM announced that the city was also freezing further spending on development of the 44th Street location. I immediately hired Samuel H. Lindenbaum, a talented attorney who specialized in zoning and who had been working until then on the 54th Street site. The other person I hired to help with the convention center was a highly dedicated woman named Louis Sunshine. Nice name, Louis Sunshine. I love the sunshine. We had extraordinary political connections. Louis had been the finance director for a huge Kerry when he ran for governor in 1974. She was also treasurer of the State Democratic Party. At first, she worked for me for particularly no pay. Later, she became an executive in our company. Excuse me. But even as I was assembling a team to promote my site, the city and state were etching their own alternative to put the convention center in Battery Park City, opposite the World Trade Center in Southern Manhattan. In my opinion, both sites, West 44th Street and Battery Park, were terrible choices. Mounting my case was another matter. I wanted to wage the battle in public, but I was an unknown. if I was going to attract attention from my site and win support for it, I had to raise my profile. I decided to call my first news conference. Luis and Howard Rubinstein, a major New York public relations executive, helped attract support from several powerful people, including Manfred Ornstein, majority leader of the state Senate, and Theodore O'Neill, the labor negotiator, who was very powerful in New York politics. Neil delivered a classic line at the press conference. Placing the new convention center in a battery park, he said, is like putting a nightclub in a graveyard. For our part, we put up a huge banner that said, Miracle on 34th Street. And I announced, before a ton of reporters, that it could build my convention center for $110 million, or at least $150 million, more than the city had estimated it would cost to build at West 44th Street. Not surprisingly, that raised some eyebrows and even got us some attention in the press. But there was a scarcely an approving pipe from the politicians. I discovered for the first time, but not the least, that politicians don't care too much what things cost. It is not their money. In promoting my site, the first thing I pointed out, whatever I meant, was how important it was to build a convention center. A lot of people were saying that the best solution, in light of the city's fiscal crisis, was to scrap the idea altogether. To me, that was classic short-sightedness. For example, in the face of a sales drop, most companies cut back on their advertising budgets. But in fact, you need advertising the most when people aren't buying. Essentially, that is what I said about a convention center. Meeting one, I argued, was critical to reviving the city's image and ultimately to putting its economy back on track. I also told everyone who would listen how great my site was, and how horrible the alternatives were. I pointed out that at 44th Street, the convention center would have to be built on platforms over the water, which would be more costly, more problematic, and ultimately more time consuming. I said that the 44th Street site was too small, that there was no room to expand it, and that because it was on the water, you would have to cross under the crumbling West Side Highway to get to it. Finally, I made a big deal out of the fact that you needed something called a non-navigable permit to build on the 44th Street site. And a non-navigable permit, which I became an expert about very quickly, is a federal approval required to build on certain waterways, and getting it requires an act of Congress. I was just a swath on the battery park site, which was an even more ridiculous location at the absolute southern tip of the city. I pointed out how remote it was from Midtown, how far from hotels and entertainment, and how inconvenient to public transportation. I also circulated a state study which concluded that building a convention center at a battery park would require a major reconstruction of the West Side Highway leading to it, as well as the addition of the less of the list of, as well as the addition of at least 2,000 new hotel rooms. Most of all, I talked about what a wonderful location I had on West 54th Street. It was on the right side of the highway, the eastern side, which meant it was easily accessible. It was closer to subways and buses than the alternative sites. I continued to make the case that the center could be built more cheaply on my site before the dispossessing any tenants. Also, because my site was so big, there was plenty of room for expansion in the future. When a group of graduate students in a class taught by city councilman Robert Wagner did a little study that treated our site the best, I managed to get hold of it and immediately cherished it the Wagner report. Its namesake wasn't thrilled. Before long, I had everything going for me, except the support of a few absolutely key people. Edwin was at the top of the list. Once he gave up on West 54th Street, Bim got behind the battery park. And no matter how many great arguments I came up with for my site, he wouldn't budge. Another major opponent was John Zucotti, a deputy mayor under Bim. He began going around town bed mounting my site. The reason, I'm convinced, was that he didn't want to admit that he had wasted several years of his life and millions of dollars of public money on a location that never made sense in the first place. And that is exactly what I said publicly. I accused him of being self-serving and petty and a half dozen other things. He got pretty railed up. The battle received a lot of media attention, and ultimately, I think it was good for my site. It became just another way to promote my site's many advantages. In the end, we won by bringing everything else down. We never gave up, and the opposition slowly began to melt away. In 1977, Bim appointed yet another committee to study the alternative sites, and it concluded that we did have the best site. On that basis, Bim finally gave us his support, although not his signature, just before leaving office at the end of the year. In January of 1978, Ed Koch took over as mayor and decided to do his own study. I figured we were back to square one, but things moved fast, and once again our site came outdated. Finally, in April 1978, the city and state announced that they had decided to purge the 54th Street site and build the convention center there. There was a victory for me, but more symbolically than financially. For all the time I'd invested, I had much less than I deserved, and nowhere near enough to justify the effort financially. As my deal with Penn Central was structured, I was paid total compensation of about $833,000, based on the $12 million price for the site that the city negotiated with Penn Central. In the end, I offered to forego my fee altogether, if the city would agree to name the convention center after my family. The city would agree to name the convention center after my family. Nice thing. I've been criticized for trying to make the trade, but I have no apologies. There wouldn't be a new convention center in New York today if it hadn't been for the tramps. More important, the city would have saved a fortune by letting me build the center, which I very much wanted to do. Instead, Ed Koch decided, by some logic I could never understand, that because I had helped arrange the sale of the property, it was a conflict for me to be the builder as well. Eventually, I offered the city a deal that, frankly, was ridiculous for me. I said I would bring the entire job in for less than $200 million. And that if there were any overruns, I would pay for them myself. You won't find many builders willing to put themselves on the line that way. Instead, the city and the state decided to oversee the job, and the result was perhaps the most horrendous construction delays and cost overruns in the history of the building business. A man named Richard Kahn was put in charge of the Urban Development Corporation, and ultimately it was his job to oversee the convention center project. Richard Kahn is a nice man, but he had visions of being the next Robert Moses. It wasn't clear that he had the experience or the talent. One of the first things Kahn did was to hire IMP as his architect. IMP is a man with a terrific reputation, but in my view, he often chooses the most expensive solution to a problem, and is virtually uncontrollable. Immediately, IMP decided to design a space frame from the center, a structural system that any professional builder will tell you is one of the most difficult to build, and is especially vulnerable to cost overruns. This is particularly true when you are dealing with the sort of huge space frames they needed for a convention center. From the very start, I told Kahn and his people that I was critical to build a parking garage simultaneously. How can you have a convention center without parking? They told me that a garage would hold up the city's environmental impact approval. Look, I said to them, those approvals are only going to be tougher to get later. And at the very least, you should begin a separate filing for the garage now, so you can at least start the process. They ignored me. And now they have no parking, and no prospect of building any in the near future. The choice of where to put the entrance was equally ill-considered. If you put the entrance at the west, the whole center faces the Hudson River, which is a beautiful view. Instead, they built the entrance on the eastern side of the building, facing that traffic on Elizabeth Avenue. As I watched all those mistakes being made, I became very angry and frustrated. In 1983, when it was clear the construction of the convention center was already a disaster of delays and overruns, I wrote a letter to William Stern, who by then had replaced Richard Kahn as president of the Urban Development Corporation. For a second time, I offered, this time for no fee at all, to oversee the project and to assure that it would get completed quickly and without further cost overruns. My offer was refused, and the disaster eventually turned into a catastrophe. By the time the convention center was finally finished last year, it was 4 years behind schedule and at least $250 million over budget. Damn! the new interest, the current cost for all those years, or for all those years of construction, the total cost was probably 1 billion or 700 million over budget. It's a lot of money. But we need to remember that Trump read this book. So always we need to hear the other side with the picture, but it's a lot of money. The construction was a terrible disgrace. The construction was a terrible disgrace. And all the worse because no one raised a fuse about it. When I was invited to attend opening day ceremonies in 1986, I refused. What happened at the convention center is that the city and the state took a great piece of property and a great project and ruined it for terrible planning and ridiculous cost overruns. Even if the convention center is ultimately a success, it can never earn back all the money that was unnecessarily squandered to build it. The funny thing about devoting so much time and energy to the 34th Street site is that I never considered it anything to compare with the 60th Street yards. The problem was that developing the 60th Street proved even more difficult than promoting the 34th Street. The community opposition was stronger. The zoning was more complicated, and the banks were highly reluctant to finance a huge residential housing project in a city still teetering on the verge of bankruptcy. In 1979, I reluctantly let my opinion on the 63 yards expire so that I could concentrate on other deals that seems more immediately promising. The first one, fittingly, was with Penry and the Penn Central. And the Penn Central for the purchase of the Commodore Hotel. Guys, thank you very much for joining me for this episode. This was the episode of today. And tomorrow we're going to start episode number 6. We're going to start new chapter 6, Grand Hotel. We're running a 49 N Street. And I ended up with the stories of this book. It's really nice and show us some a little bit how the entrepreneurial world is working. And I learned some nice things from it. So guys, again, I want to say thank you very much for joining for this great episode of the AK Book Club, the greatest book club in the world, the AK Book Club. And I really appreciate the fact that you invest your time with me, so thank you very much. And if you got so go out guys, inspire the world, if I get them, if you have many friends and neighbors, make a difference because you are here. Share a message, work on English, work on your appearance for the camera, work on the appearance on the screen, control and master the art of how to communicate well for this device, how to market yourself, how to share a message with the world. And if you got the corona, please stay at home, stay safe until the corona is behind us, because we are aware of the fact that a lot of people around the world got sick from this coronavirus, and a lot of people might lose some of their family members, friends, or neighbors to this coronavirus. And just want to let you know, guys, that all AK Book Club community and all AK Book Club family send their own best wishes for you, and we are praying for you to feel better, and we want to support you. And I hope that this book club inspires you a little bit, or make you better, or make your day better. A little bit, because I'm trying to do it entertaining and to provide you the best content that I can. And I wish you guys the best. So guys, thank you very much for joining me, and I really hope to see you all tomorrow for the next episode of the IK Book Club, the greatest book club in the world. Right now I'm going to shoot my third episode on this day. So guys, thank you very much, and just hope to see you all tomorrow, guys, for the next episode of the greatest book club in the world. Until then, have a great time. Take care of yourself, and bye-bye. Peace.